Thank you for joining me in the History of Science Collections of the University of Oklahoma Libraries. Let's look at a few treasures from the vault that throw light on the story of Stonehenge. On this geological map of England and Wales, prepared by William Smith in 1815, Stonehenge seems to rise up out from the earth on the Salisbury Plain, right between the A and I in the word plain. Stonehenge lies less than 10 miles due north of Salisbury. To enter the world of the people who made Stonehenge, we need to get away from our streetlights, look up at the stars, and make ourselves at home in the starry heavens. Here is Cygnus the Swan, flying above the river of the Milky Way. This atlas by Johann Bode, printed in 1801, represents a high-level fusion of artistic beauty and science. Bode plotted more than 17,000 stars and 2,500 nebula among the figures of the constellations. Few atlases are larger or more beautiful. After Bode's monumental effort, scientific star atlases became more specialized or dispensed altogether with the artistic depiction of constellation figures. Until recently, evening hours, day after day, were filled with the beauty of the nighttime sky. But most of us today would find one night spent under truly dark skies an unforgettable experience. On this page, we can see the constellations of Gemini, Orion, and Taurus. Orion the Hunter and Taurus the Bull, Gemini the Twins. These are three of the most prominent constellations of the winter hexagon. Many constellations, including these three, are of Babylonian origin. 88 constellations are officially recognized today. Here is the constellation of Orion the Hunter. This beautiful work was written as an introduction to the nighttime sky, as a delightful dialogue between a mother and her daughter. Another plate shows a striking depiction of the full moon against the backdrop of a completely dark sky. And my favorite is at the very front, a fold-out plate that shows the constellations of Corvus, Crater, and Hydra. Whitwell's 400-page book includes 23 engraved plates, four of them hand-colored. Flashcards are a great way to become acquainted with the constellations. This set, titled Urania's Mirror, was published in 1823 by Jehoshaphat Aspen. Holes in the cards, for the stars, allow you to look through the card at a light and see the constellation pattern appear. Here's the card for the Big Dipper, the Big Bear, Ursa Major. We can see the Big Dipper inside the hindquarters of the bear. Four stars make the bowl, and three stars make the handle. Only the most imaginative can see a bear surrounding the Big Dipper. His nose is located far off to the side. The handles of the Big and Little Dippers represent the tails of the Big and Little Bears on ancient star maps, even though modern bears don't have tails. The Big Bear was regarded as a bear before Homer, and an ancient Greek story explains why the Big and Little Bears have their tails stretched out. Many star patterns look like dippers, triangles, or squares in the sky. There are very few that actually resemble bears or people, yet constellations were named to honor particular characters in ancient stories, not because the star pattern actually looked like the character being honored. It took imagination to invent the constellation figures a long time ago, and it takes imagination to learn them now. This is Sagittarius the Archer, a centaur, another constellation dating to Babylonian times. If we track the motion of the sun around the constellations over the course of a year, we'll find that the sun follows the same path year after year, over and over again. The sun's path is called the ecliptic, And any constellation that includes the ecliptic is called a zodiac constellation. Zodiac means circle of animals, since all but one of the zodiac constellations are named after living beings, either animal or human or some kind of hybrid. The planets never stray far from the ecliptic. So an unexpected bright star in any zodiac constellation might be a planet wandering through on its journey around the sky. The entire sky can be represented by the ecliptic and the equator on an armillary sphere like this one. With an armillary sphere, we can track the apparent motions of the sun, moon, and planets along the ecliptic. The great circle of the ecliptic, shown here in brass, lies at an angle of 23.5 degrees from the circle of the celestial equator. This fact was reported by Plato in his dialogue, The Timaeus. This 18th century book by Benjamin Martin explains how to use the armillary sphere. Other fundamental astronomical instruments include a celestial globe, a terrestrial globe, because the geography of the Earth and the cartography of the skies coincides, and an orrery, which is a piece of clockwork to model the motions of planets. Martin operated an instrument shop in London, and he wrote more than 60 different catalogs and manuals to promote popular understanding of astronomy and interest in scientific instruments. Have you noticed the days growing shorter in the fall and longer in the spring? Have you noticed how the sun rises at different locations on the eastern horizon, depending on the time of year? At Stonehenge and other stone circles, pre-literate cultures used giant stones or megaliths as their armillary spheres, charting seasonal intervals by arranging sunrise markers sided toward the eastern and western horizons. Let's say we're facing due east along the horizon. So we need a horizon. And we're watching the sun rise in Leo the Lion. And a megalith of Stonehenge is right there along the horizon. Twice a year, the sun will rise directly above this megalith. In the early morning hours, as the sun rises, the megalith can point to the location of the sun. The 2 days each year when the sun rises due east, it also sets due west. And those are the equinoxes, where the lengths of the day and the night are equal. But on the other dates through the year, the sun does not rise due east. Rather, we see the sun rise at points running north or south of due east, maybe over here or over here. The position of the sun changes its rising point along the eastern horizon like a pendulum swinging back and forth through the year. The 2 days each year when the sunrises reach their extreme northerly and extreme southerly reaches on the horizon, when the sun seems to stand still before turning back and going the other way, are called the solstices. So the summer solstice and the winter solstice can be marked on the horizon with additional megaliths. The changing horizon points of sunrises and sunsets, and similar patterns for the moon, are obvious astronomical phenomena that were observed by pre-literate cultures using stone circles like Stonehenge. Perhaps pre-literate cultures knew more about the motions of the sun and moon along the horizon than most 21st century Americans. Some astronomers will go further and say that Stonehenge was the first astronomical observatory, but we need to be cautious about such claims, which involve additional assumptions. In a well-known book, astronomer Gerald Hawkins claimed that the circle of Aubrey holes were used to predict lunar eclipses, Stonehenge decoded. The astronomer Fred Hoyle came up with a different method by which he could use the same structures to predict eclipses as well. But the exercises of Hawkins and Hoyle are largely beside the point because we have little evidence that the structures were actually used by the builders of Stonehenge in that way. Any 10 stones in a rough circle will display a number of alignments with significant astronomical points on the horizon simply due to chance. Such rational reconstruction is not history. There is also the inherent difficulty of determining alignments. Should one sight from the left or from the right side of the selected stones? Or even cross over, sighting from one side of the near stone toward the opposite side of the far stone? Should one aim for the first gleam of sunrise, the midpoint of the solar disk, or the first moment when we can see the full face of the sun? A host of writers on Stonehenge fall prey to rational reconstruction or writing history backwards. Their enthusiasm for reading present-day knowledge back into the past clouds their historical sensibility. So rational reconstruction, sometimes called Whig history or presentism, all mean writing history backwards, evaluating the past in terms of present knowledge, interpreting Stonehenge as if it were a modern astronomical observatory. Certainly, there were no telescopes at Stonehenge, and who is to say that Stonehenge was an observatory instead of a temple? Who is to say that it was designed for coolly rational scientists instead of hot-blooded priests? Who says astronomy and priestcraft were incompatible at that time, anyway? Rational reconstruction obscures many interesting questions. It undermines our historical sensibility and projects modern perspectives onto the past in a way that hinders our understanding of the way they saw their own world. So what do we really know of the actual people who created Stonehenge? Not much. There are no inscriptions, no writings, no books in which they explained for our benefit what they were doing and why they did it. Just a heap of stones. This is why historians sometimes say that history begins at Sumer in ancient Mesopotamia, rather than with archaeology and archaeoastronomy, as valuable and as interesting as those disciplines are. But there's another way Stonehenge entered written historical texts, and that is the story of how Stonehenge has been interpreted. How have people understood Stonehenge? Throughout most of the period covered by this course, residents of Britain seemed satisfied with the explanation that giants had built Stonehenge, or perhaps Merlin constructed it by his strange magic arts. During the 16th and 17th centuries, however, a variety of writers became interested in the study of Britain's past and searched for new evidence that might help them explain Stonehenge as a part of human history. Here is a study of Stonehenge written by Walter Charlton, an important English atomist and a member of the Royal Society of London. This copy is unbound and untrimmed, stitched together just as it was issued by the London publisher in 1663. The title is Coria Gigantum, or The Most Famous Antiquity of Great Britain, Vulgarly Called Stonehenge, Standing on Salisbury Plain, Restored to the Danes. There's a wonderful fold-out plate that is the most striking early depiction of Stonehenge on which you can see the massive trilithon stones, the three stones resembling a lintel. all arranged in a circular pattern. Charlton had background knowledge of the history of Danish artifacts and pointed out that the Danes had occupied southern England in the 8th century. By comparison with Danish monuments, Charlton argued that the Danes built Stonehenge as a parliamentary meeting place and a site for inaugurating kings. By investigating the past and recovering what he believed to be the original purpose of Stonehenge, Charlton thought he was restoring his own King Charles II to an ancient throne. So how are we to know the purpose for which Stonehenge was built? If astronomers like Hawkins are tempted to project their own knowledge of astronomy back into the story of Stonehenge, we see that Charlton's efforts were similarly limited by the historical evidence available. Yet once Charlton framed the question in historical terms, the story of Stonehenge could be pursued as a constant search for new evidence of any kind, interpreted in an open-ended process. History is like that. History is open-ended. The lesson for us is this: to understand Stonehenge, we will need to combine science and history. We will need all the resources at our disposal, and we'll need to be constantly on the lookout for new evidence. On the one hand, our grasp of astronomy must be equal to that of the people who made it. But on the other hand, to know astronomy is not enough to understand Stonehenge. To avoid speculation and rational reconstruction, we also need a historical sensibility that alerts us to how people in the past were different from us in interesting and unexpected ways. So this book by Charlton represents the beginning of the quest to interpret Stonehenge with a historical perspective. We may follow Charlton by avoiding rational reconstruction, not only with respect to Stonehenge, but in all of our investigations of the story of science, from Stonehenge to the age of Newton. Science is a story. What stories do you want to hear and tell about Stonehenge?